Don't ever underestimate the heart of a champion.
Ha ha, welcome. This is the Sports Trapp Podcast, and my name is John Trapp. Next to me, Chris Rodriguez. How you doing, sir?
What it do?
Coming from the H-Town, Houston, Texas.
Trying to get my sluggish percentage up like La Pina. You know how it is.
There you go. And of course, always one on the ones and twos, Mr. Qua.
What up?
How are we doing, ladies and gentlemen? Thank you for joining us. As always, however you guys are listening to us, thank you. Once again, we are bringing to you episode number 10.
10. Diaz.
Woo!
Boom.
Man. I'm pretty excited.
Yeah, Astros doing pretty good. Got Astros, Dodgers, Yankees, all in the first place. Let's see. Somebody has to lead off with the Houston Rockets. A little Houston Rockets news. James Harden had a huge, huge week this week. A little camp. Finally speaks. CP3 sends a good little heartfelt goodbye to the city of Houston. And, of course, we always got to bring up the trade of the year so far. Westbrook coming to Houston, Texas. First, I got to bring up, though, it's been brought to my attention that we should kind of give a little apology to Vincent Goodwill.
Who?
Vincent Goodwill.
I don't know who that is.
But I got to say, I'm not going to do that. I can't do that. As a fan of the Houston Rockets, as a sports commentator, if you want to say this, or even analysis, when I analyze everything, when I take everything in, I got to believe that Vincent Goodwill or whoever wanted to report on the Houston Rockets having serious beef between James Harden and CP3, when I connect all the dots, I still can't find any reason to actually back up that claim. So I'm not going to apologize. I'm not going to say that he had a point because CP3 left and we traded him for somebody that, unfortunately for CP3, is a better player than him at this point. It's identical contracts. It's identical contracts when you add up the pieces. Russell Westbrook makes just the same amount of money, only has an extra year, right? So when you take that in consideration and you give picks that the Rockets gave to OKC, in this instance, they gave them two first-round picks and two the ability to swap two other picks, I don't see how that's leveraging our future or even alluding to the fact that James Harden and Chris Paul actually had beef. When I look at it, apples to apples, it's stat to stat. It's just a better move for the Houston Rockets that want the owner has come out and said that he wants to win now. So if anything, he's leveraged our future for a championship this year. Right here, right now, this is our shot. For all intents and purposes, this is the best team that the Houston Rockets have had with James Harden on the team.
His reporting, his sources from other reporters came out and said that his sources weren't correct and that it came from a bad place. It came from a bad source. And you know.
Yeah, there's rumors where it was like a disgruntled employee that came out and said
there's a couple
that.
Of coaches that got let go. And there's a couple of people that got so
to say the least.
Even the story that he told that was on live TV was ridiculous in itself. And if you believe those ridiculous stories, hey, that's on you. Listen, at the end of the day, our whole thing is that we're gonna defend, you know, our teams when it's time to, and when it's time to criticize our teams, we're actually gonna do that as well.
So, as we always do at this time, we gotta introduce something from the H, something to give our city some love. Mr. Chris Rodriguez, would you please do us the favor, introduce our brew of the day?
Listen, man, here in Houston, we all about those Cougars, right? Here we go, U of H. This is the brew of the H. This is actually the U of H Cougars official beer. And this comes all the way from the No Label Brewing Company out in Katy, Texas, which is...
Katy, Texas?
is definitely
appreciate you.
Houston, either way it goes.
Pass this on to Mr. Quall here.
Absolutely. Let me open it up for you. This is my first time actually trying a no label a beer, so I'm pretty excited about that. I love the can. I love the logo. So
yeah, this is the first time we actually featured a no label.
There you go, Quall with the U of H. That wasn't even that was actually by accident that he wore that hat today, huh?
Let's check this out. As we open this beer, you mentioned a little someone of the likes of Mr. LeBron James.
Taco Tuesday. Yeah.
Taco Tuesday. I can't believe you don't like that. I kind of like that.
No, it's lame.
But him and the Los Angeles Lakers feel a little sour right now.
Oh,
they're feeling a little, what was the word? Played?
Played. It's funny that the national media and people like the Lakers even came out, because like 3 episodes back, I actually said that the Kawhi Leonard had been playing the Lakers from the start. From everything that you, like, Kawhi Leonard is somebody who is a very strategic person. Like, he's the type of person that wakes up every day at the same time. This is my opinion now. That wakes up every day. I want to make sure I put that out there. He's the type of person that wakes up every day at the same time. He probably eats the same thing every day for breakfast, for lunch, and for dinner. He's very, very strategic in everything he does. And when you go back and you hear all these stories, and I said it, Kawhi was playing the Lakers the whole time.
Here's what I think is ridiculous in all of this. The Lakers. The Lakers.
They're the ones crying, right?
Said that they were feeling played. Hold on.
The same way they played the Pelicans?
So you had LeBron James, his number right-hand man, his agent, Rich Paul.
Mm-hmm.
In the middle of last season, or the season prior, excuse me, in the middle of that season, AD switches agents.
Yeah.
To who? None other than Rich Paul. All of a sudden, he wants to be out of his contract.
Paul, when you go back, can you actually play some like conspiracy type music when we start talking about this? Because this is what it boils down to, and I don't want to spend too much time on this. Because I think it is hypocritical of the Lakers of all people to say that. But I just think that it sounds like some sour grapes, because they got beaten at their own game by someone they didn't expect it. And I keep saying this, you always put money on the silent, quiet person. The Lakers thought that they were the only ones playing chess. Found out that they actually were playing checkers, because Kawhi Leonard had it down from the gate. He knew what he was doing. He got what he wanted, and then some. And at the same time, by keeping the Lakers on hold, they missed out on some other free agents as well that they could have added to the team to make them better. And now, in hindsight, it seems like, you know, they were a little bit worried that he was going to join a team with the Lakers. But now it just seems like the NBA season next year is going to be super exciting, because it seems even filled. You know?
It's a NBA of super duos, to say the very least. It's going to be open. It's going to be exciting. It's going to be the most watched NBA season, in my opinion, in a long, long time, because a lot of teams have an actual very good chance of winning it this season. One thing I wanted to bring up was Kawhi Leonard and the Clippers. Kawhi Leonard himself had a meeting with Toronto, had a meeting with LA Lakers, and he had a meeting with the Clippers, of course. And he joined the Clippers. But in all of that, he went to Kevin Durant first and asked him to join. Then he goes to Paul George. Now there's rumors reporting that had Paul George not opted out and not joined the Clippers, he didn't even opt out. He asked to be traded. He asked to be out of the get out of the team in OKC. Had he not done that, and had he not gotten traded to the Clippers, Kawhi Leonard was actually going to go after James Harden.
Yeah, the rumors is that the Clippers actually reached out to Daryl Morey and the Rockets to see how they felt about possibly trading James Harden. It's just crazy. And now, all of a sudden, just a couple of days ago, there was definitely a governor's meeting with the NBA
See, you bring that up, and I'm so glad you brought that up, because this is one thing I always kind of felt uneasy about. So for almost 2 years in advance, AD has to be traded, and whatever you want to call it, you want to call it collusion or you want to call it even unethical at the very least.
No collusion.
All right, so you have LeBron James come out, talk about AD, whether that was correct or not to do. I'm not too sure, right?
Yeah.
But he also had LeBron James's agent do that.
Right.
To become AD's agent. So at the very least, that's kind of sketchy. And I'm not saying directly LeBron James told AD to get out of his contract or whatever you want to call it, agreement with the New Orleans Pelicans. But at the end of the day, if you connect the dots and you're just looking for little details here and there, you start to pick up some crumbs of some cookies out there. And that's one of them. Now, number two, Kawhi Leonard comes out and he asks other players, maybe Kevin Durant's not necessarily under contract, at least he played it out, but with Paul George, when he had just signed an extension, the very next year, Paul George calls the front office of OKC and says he wants out because Kawhi Leonard asked him to. Now, I'm not saying there's rules. It's rules right now against that, but that does not sound like that's an ethical way of doing business. Now, if you want to say that he played the Lakers, I don't care. The Lakers don't get in a boo-hoo, and for me, I don't feel bad for them at all. The way they play the game, I don't feel bad. The only person I feel any type of way from the Lakers.
Lonzo Ball. He's supposed to be a Laker for life.
Well, that, yeah. Yeah.
Sorry.
But the one person I feel like the Lakers should probably kind of tone down at all is Magic Johnson. Because if Lakers had any shot, in my opinion, of getting Kawhi Leonard, Magic Johnson ruined it. Let's be honest. Kawhi Leonard doesn't like his business out there. So if you have a player come out and
well, this is what happened when you hire a part-time person for a full-time job. You get bullshit. Sorry, Magic.
So when you get somebody out of their contract or wants to get out of their contract and go join a team because he ended up getting out of the contract, I think that's bad business.
Well, this is what I think. I told you, the players completely control the game now. It's gotten out of hand. And
is that a good thing or bad thing?
Well, like here's the thing. I think all of us as employees, we want to be able to control our livelihood, right? We want to be able to control our money. We want to be able to control where we get promoted to, how we get promoted, right? But every once in a while, some of us employees actually become owners. And so what I want you guys to think about right now is how would you personally, you know, perceive to go about your company if this was to happen to you, where employees decided to dictate where they were going to go, where they decided to tell you when they were going to come into work and who they were going to or when they were going to come in and how they were going to get paid. So there definitely has to be organization. There definitely has to be some type of structure because unfortunately you can't allow your employees or the players in general to basically shit on the rules and do whatever they want. Because if you've ever been a boss of anything, you know that when you don't give your employees structure and discipline, it's gonna make you look bad as from a leadership standpoint. So I just think now, like, if you don't, the way they should do it is that if you try to get out of your contract, then you should get 50% of your money taken away from you. You have to give 50% of the money back to that organization that's paid you.
Ooh, that's a lot because
no,
one
not.
Of the things that CBA does never wants to do, or excuse me, the Players Association never wants to do, is right now they have guaranteed contracts. Mm-hmm. They never want to give back money.
Let me ask you something. If you decide to tomorrow that you wanted to get out of your electric company, are you going to have to pay a price?
Yes.
What happens if you have to get out of your cell phone contract? You have to pay a price?
Yes.
Okay. That's just it. If you want to get out of your contract and you want to abide by those rules, you have to pay a fee.
That's a good point.
Honestly, think about this.
But see, here's what they do. And when you get traded, yep, there's a trade kicker that kicks in. So for players that have the demand, once they get traded, they in their contract it states you'll make an extra $2 million or something like that. So it creates an incentive for teams not to trade them. But what ends up happening is those players, to get to the team that they want, they waive that. So I don't see that there's any way for players to necessarily do what you're saying, but not say that it's unprecedented. So James Harden and Brody on one team, does this sound like the Houston Rockets are desperate, or does this sound like the Houston Rockets have just pushed all their cards to the middle and said, we're all in? Well,
man, you can't please anybody, because everybody either loves a trade or they hate the trade. There's no middle ground to it at this point right now, and we won't know how it plays out, and we've talked about this. But honestly, at the end of the day, they're doing what they need to do to make James Harden happy. It was obvious, and I'm a Chris Paul fan, that Chris Paul struggled immensely getting past his man. He could not get he couldn't even get past certain centers that he normally has gotten past because age caught up with him.
Is this the end all be all for the Rockets?
Listen, I'm gonna quote something real fast. James Harden, just FYI, you know, those who don't know, but recently the Rockets star James Harden actually bought minority stake in the MLS, Houston Dynamo, which I think is huge. And what he said was, it was time. You know, he said, I'm invested. This is my city. I'm here to stay. Ooh. I know to bring a championship in basketball, and I will. That's coming very soon, very soon. I just had to show appreciation and let you guys know that I'm part of this city forever. So
he showed up to the Real Madrid game that came out and a Houston Dynamo game.
He's definitely a big soccer fan. He's talked about how the game of soccer has definitely become, you know, extremely popular in the States. But to me, that's a tell-all. When he sits there and says that I'm part of the city forever, when you go back and you listen to some of the sound bites, he talks about how he's so happy that he doesn't have to worry about the NBA shuffle. He's so happy that he has an organization that's committed to him, that even when they see that there needs to be improvements to the team, like getting rid of a controversial trade like James, you know, Chris Paul for Brody, that they're willing to pull that trigger because they want to make sure that James Harden is here for life. That, to me, is an impressive organization, and I commend Daryl Morey a lot, because listen, his career is on the line here. If Brody and Harden doesn't work out,
That's it for
Daryl Morey.
I do believe that Daryl Morey has put all his chips on the table and said, I'm all in. He is, and I fault him at no point for doing this, because for what James Harden brings, he's an all-generation talent. He's one of those talents that you know, you don't see every day. And you know, when he came to the Rockets, we didn't know what we were getting.
Nobody did, and everybody doubted it. I remember when that trade happened.
Even through this whole process, Daryl Morey has come out and said nothing but good things about James Harden, nothing but good things about CP3. And then you have people like PJ Tucker coming out, and when they interview him, and they say Austin Rivers, he re-signed how because he loved this team so much, and that says so much about a team when you have somebody that all the NBA media says that James Harden's a ball hog, that the usage rate is too much, that when I'm gonna shout out Kendrick Perkins right now, he personally, the way I felt, he wanted Brody to go to the Miami Heat. And who did Brody choose? The Houston Rockets. With the next most highly used NBA player in the entire league.
Well, just so you know, now all of a sudden he's praising the Rockets. He's praising the organization. He's praising the move with saying that Harden is a great teammate, that he's not a ball hog, that Brody and Harden are going to work out. Because secretly, I think Perkins wants to be a coach somewhere, or he wants to be in player development. So I just think that Perkins is trying to, you know, somehow kind of gravitate to where, you know, he's going to fit in that sense. So
for somebody to talk with such a draw, and I'm nobody to talk, because I can have that draw myself. But at the same time, somebody that has such a draw, I think he does a good job on air. I'm not big on critiquing other people, but at the same time, I do feel like a lot of people have an agenda. And I'm not one to hide mine in a sense of I'm a Rockets fan. I'm a 49er fan. And I'm not going to sit here and say that I don't have biases and I don't think that certain teams aren't as good as mine. I'm not going to sit here and hide behind those biases and deny those. Excuse me. But at the same time, when you look at, and I try to be objective as possible, when you look at the way the Rockets are constructed and how many players want to come to play with us and how many examples that you have out there that show how the Rockets are committed to James Harden and how much James Harden's committed to the Rockets, this is one of the best examples of a team rallying around a player and saying, you know what, we're going to play and put the best people and best team around you to in order for you to win a championship. And at the end of the day, when you have a team and you go all in for a championship, no matter what, no matter if you go into the luxury tax, no matter if you spend an exorbitant amount of money for the next best player, who in this case in point is an MVP or was an MVP who's averaged a triple-double for the past 3 years. Let me just say that one more time. MVP with averaging a triple-double for the past 3 years next to your best player, right? When you do that and you win a championship, I'm not saying that it's an automatic guarantee, but when you do that and you win a championship, your stock skyrockets. For when LeBron James went to the Miami Heat and he won the championship, their stock rose 37% for the next year. In 1 year, that's hundreds of millions of dollars.
You know, it's kind of crazy how the Rockets have gotten a lot of criticism for trading for Brody, because the first thing that came out of their mouths is, well, that's not a Maury pick, because he doesn't fit the profile of analytics, right? But that's been the biggest cry from the critics of the Rockets, is that they're too analytic based. Right, so now that we go against the grain, and now we don't. So at the end of the day,
that is funny.
At the end of the day, I'm just gonna come to straight to the point. You ain't got to like the Houston Rockets, all right? But if you don't like the Houston Rockets, just come out and say you don't like the Houston Rockets, that you don't like the city of Houston. That's fine, because we love it when we're hated on, because at the end of the day, we are the true underdog. We are the fastest growing city. We are one of the greatest, if not the greatest city of all time. And yes, the Texans are not that good. And yes, the Rockets have not won a championship. And yes, the Cougars struggle at times. But the point being is that this city is the greatest city. It is the reflection of diversity. It's the reflection of loyalty. It's a reflection of chill. It's a reflection of working hard and treating each other with respect and dignity, the same way the Rockets organization has done to James Harden, is what we've been doing as a city. And at the end of the day, we got the Astros.
So, hey man, episode number 10. Woo! Let's do it. Thank you, H-Town. Anyway, so we were talking about the net worth of teams and stuff, and Forbes list has come out with their top 10, and I gotta say, Dallas Cowboys, once again, reign supreme. What does that say about Houston? I mean, excuse me. What does that say about U.S.-based teams that don't win but are worth more than any other franchise in the entire world?
The Dallas Cowboys, to me, are compared to Apple phones.
Apple?
Mm-hmm, Apple.
Oh, my God.
You know how the Apple phone hasn't done shit in the last 10 years as far as a phone, that they're so behind when it comes to technology? But people buy Apple all the time. You know why?
Why?
Because it's been branded so well. Because there's a history behind Very Apple. Good. Because of what they've done with technology and what they've done to change the whole phone game as we know it, right? That's the exact same thing with the Cowboys. And trust me, the Cowboy haters out there, I'm not trying to sit here and say the Cowboys are remotely anything that they were 20 years ago, but let's be real here. The Cowboys have an incredible brand. And what makes the Cowboys so different from everyone else is every time they sell a t-shirt, every time they sell a hat, They get to keep all the revenue. They're the only sports team that can
do that. Wow, that's why they were so much.
That's why they were so much. And how did they get that? Just because they were America's favorite team. And at one point, they really were. Like the Dallas Cowboys, and you go back and you look at the history, you have to respect that. And this, you know, as much as I am a Houston fan, I'm also a Texas fan. So you have to give respect to the Cowboys for what they've done. And at the end of the day, when you are a Houston Texan, the only thing you care about is winning a championship. So you can look at the Cowboy fans next to you and say, what now? What now? We have a championship. So
is it more important for the owner to – now think of this. This sports in America is a billion-dollar industry. NBA, NFL, MLB, whatever you want to call it. So with that being said, you realize it's a business.
Yeah.
Is it more important to be number one on a Forbes list or to win a championship?
If you have to, if you ask me personally, if you're the Houston Texans, is to be on the Forbes list, because that's pretty much what they've been on the last 10 years. They've been on the Forbes list because they're also on the Forbes list as well as one of the most successful teams from a revenue standpoint.
Right.
But they have truly how many winning seasons?
Yeah, they don't have. They haven't have won in like 25 years.
So that's why I always get frustrated with Houston fans. I love the fact that we support our Texans, and rightfully so, because they are our only football team ever since the Oilers left. But at the same time, when is it going to come a point that the Houston fans start holding the owners accountable about putting a product out there that is truly winning? Because at the end of the day, we still don't have an identity. We still don't have a true winning tradition. And it seems like every year we don't know what's going on. But I can tell you what has been successful for the Houston Texans is that they keep selling jerseys.
Qual, can you do me a favor? Look up in that Forbes list, look up where the Houston Texans are. Because I don't feel
22.
Like 22. Yep. In the world.
That's pretty damn
good. I will say that's good, especially when in the state of Texas, you have the greatest franchise in the world, right? What were you going to say?
Guess who we're tied with, because we are tied with somebody.
I'm going to take a wild guess after looking on your screen. The Boston Celtics.
Yep.
Boston Celtics. Dude, that's not bad.
That's not bad at all.
I do think the NFL overall probably still makes more money than any other sports entity out there, yeah. right. So the one thing I noticed when I looked at that Forbes list, right, was so you have teams like the Cowboys haven't won in 20 years. You have teams like the Lakers who haven't won in, I want to say, since Kobe, so that's about 10 plus years. You have if you keep going down or up, excuse me, you have these other, the New York Knicks. Oh, my God. They haven't won since, 70-something, right? So you have all these teams that don't win, but then you have the teams that aren't American, like Real Madrid, Barcelona. There's a couple other off the top of my head I can't remember that I noticed that they consistently win. Mm-hmm. That's a very opposite of how we do business here. And I don't understand that. I feel like fans are too forgiving when it comes to their teams.
Maybe, but at the end of the day, it's also about branding. They started off being dominant historically, these teams. And even though they might not have been successful in the last couple of years or the last decade, they still have branding. Because guess what? We all know for a fact that Dallas Cowboys are not America's favorite team. But those who believe that they are America's favorite team are raising those same generation, the next generation, up to believe that. So it's all about branding, just like people believe that Apple is the greatest phone ever.
But,
and it's not.
Okay, so the number two is the Yankees, yeah. Right? They haven't won in a long, long, long time. But I would think their branding is better than the Cowboys.
But they're number two, right?
Right.
The Yankees? I mean, that's still, again.
Baseball, but look at, if you look at all the leagues, right, you look at NFL, MLB, and NBA, you would think that NFL rules because of the way the contracts are structured, the way that the branding is, the way that that essentially the player contracts are paid for before the first game of the season. See, like we were talking about last episode, preseason tickets are sold at regular price.
Think about it like this. A lot of people who don't necessarily follow football around the world, like America does.
You talking about NFL football?
NFL football. Not football, but NFL football.
Football.
But a lot of their first experiences or what they know about football is the Cowboys, America's favorite team, because that's how it was highlighted for such a long time.
What were you going to say, Kwan?
Say America's team. It's not America's favorite team.
Well, America's team. Well, if you're America's team, you would think you're America's favorite team, right?
So what's the number two NFL team?
Want to take a guess?
I'm going to go with the Oakland Raiders.
49ers.
Patriots.
Yeah. That makes sense. But yeah, see, Patriots win. That's the thing. Patriots win. So if you go look at the rankings, you have LA hasn't won in a while. You have the Knicks that haven't won. The Yankees that haven't won in a while.
One is the Giants for NFL.
So
and
you
then
know
the Rams. Wow.
But see, now I'm surprised
about the Redskins.
I'm surprised. The Redskins I'm not so much surprised about. But the Rams, yeah, because they actually just moved out of San Diego St. Louis, excuse me. I got my S's confused. So they moved out of St. Louis after winning, what was it, one or two? Best show on turf. How many championships did they win? One.
I think they won one. Just one.
So they
Marshall Faulk, baby.
They had actually a good team. It's right when they left because they drafted what's his name?
Jeff Goff?
Jared
Goff.
Jared Goff. Jeff, I don't know why I wanted to say Jeff.
I just play with him.
We'll edit that out. Jared Goff. So they built a good team right when they left. So I'm kind of surprised about that.
I'm not, because, again, it's all about branding. They have an iconic jersey. They have iconic colors. And they have such a rich history from playing in Los Angeles to going to St. Louis and coming right back to Los Angeles. So I'm not surprised at all.
Okay, so you got the Golden State Warriors, who are the next best NBA team. That's not.
Well, you got to think about it. Like, how many people travel to that area, that Bay Area of California? How many people who have come from other countries that come into America and they become acquainted to their city? Like, Los Angeles is still one of the greatest cities, or just California in general is one of the greatest states. So when you're moving from, whether it's within the state or you're moving outside of the country, I mean, the Golden State Warriors are iconic. They've won. And you can actually relate, or you can become, I guess, engulfed into the actual team because you have someone that's as courageous and as athletic and gifted as a Steph Curry and a Kevin Durant, right? So it makes sense. I mean, again, great branding.
No. I get what I'm. I think that my point is that when the teams that win are high on that Forbes list, then it's merited. It makes sense. But for teams that don't win, i.e., case in point, the Cowboys, I don't understand how year in and year out that you could have a franchise that does not hold their own their own championship values to itself, and they consistently year in and year out are held as the team.
Because there's always that hope that next year is the year. That's it. When you're a loyal fan, listen, I'm a loyal fan to the Houston Rockets. Every year I tell you we're going to win a championship, and we don't. And I have to suck it. I have to suck it.
What are the Rockets? Are they even in the top 50? Yeah, in all offense, I'm not saying that they should or shouldn't be, but, I mean, the Rockets, they're held to a certain flame. It's amazing to me how
we are 38. We're tied with the Carolina Panthers.
Damn, that hurts.
And the New York Mets.
Carolina Panthers, who were one of the last teams to be added to the NFL. But regardless.
I bet you we're number one in China. Boom.
That's probably what helps us out.
The Asian market. Thank you so much. Shout out to everyone out there. Philippines, Vietnam, China.
I want to kind of switch it up a little bit to something a little bit more somber. Something a little, I think, that has a little bit more value because it's a human life. And I want to speak on a little bit about the boxing and the way it's ran. There's a Russian fighter that over the past weekend, he got into it, and they stopped the fight in the 11th round because he was consistently getting hit over and over and over. And unfortunately, over the weekend, he passed away. Boxing has had a black eye on this sport for a while. And nobody seems to care. Nobody seems to bat an eye because it's not Manny Pacquiao, because it's not Floyd Mayweather. These are the best of the best, and I understand that. But when you have something of a sport that this consistently happens in a world, in a U.S. Environment that we have that is so anti-concussion right now when it comes to the NFL, and it permeates the other sports, right? We're so worried about the concussion. We allow this in boxing to not happen once, not happen twice. You have to understand, every time a boxer gets knocked down and they have to do a count, it's a concussion. It's a direct injury to the brain of a human being. And so the way the boxing is set up, it allows this to happen over and over and over again. And I'm not saying the sport of boxing has to go away, but it has to change. Because not only do they do this and get concussed every fight and get knocked out every fight, and we watch it like a train wreck every fight, but they also pass away. And it's not just one instance. It's over and over and over again. Last year it happened. It happened twice last year. I don't even know if this is the first time it's happened this year. But something has to be done. Something has to be looked at. And I don't want it to come to a big name boxer that this happens to. But I think that's the road that we're going down.
So what do you oppose, John? I mean, what do you think they need to do about it?
One.
So if you get knocked out, the fight's over?
Yeah, one, yes.
But then how many times have we watched boxing where a fighter goes down, comes back and wins and knocks the other fighter out?
How many times have...
That's happened a lot. That's probably happened more times than someone getting knocked out and dying.
Okay.
So that's been the whole point of boxing. Like, your favorite... I'm sure one of your favorite boxing movies is Rocky.
Right.
So based off of what you said, Rocky would have lost the first round, second round. And it wouldn't have been a great story.
Yeah, okay. I don't want to shoot holes in that because it's a movie, but I get what you're saying.
But that movie was based on a real fighter, though. Technically.
Not necessarily.
Somebody who kind of had the same similar story that came from nothing. That's what boxing has always resembled.
Bullshit. No. And you know why I must call it bullshit?
It's not.
You know this to be fact. It used to be bare knuckle boxing, right?
Right.
They put gloves, right?
Right.
Made the sport safer, right?
Right.
All right. Do you see us go back to bare knuckle fighting, this whether it's the past week, past month, or whatever? Have you seen the fighters after those fights? It's brutal. It's barbaric. I'm sorry. It's not a fun sport to watch. It isn't.
Well, based off your notation, then they should just go ahead and get rid of all type of fighting sports.
That's not true.
No, because a UFC is just as brutal.
Okay, UFC.
It's just as brutal.
Yeah, but
and they don't even have health insurance.
Do they die?
There's been definitely UFC fighters that have died.
Yes, look it
have.
Up. No, there hasn't.
Been. Yes, there has been.
I mean, I'm not saying a UFC fighter hasn't passed away. I understand there's a brutalness of the sport. Football, I understand that there's
brutalness. There was a UFC fighter that passed away last year.
he fought in the UFC, but he hasn't he did not fight at the top. UFC, let's just put it like this. UFC is the top, right? NFL is the top. NBA is the top. When you look at it, when boxing, you don't have those the like top rank entities and stuff like that that allows you to say, oh, this is the end all be all. But at the end of the day, boxing is at a level that everybody's basically fighting on their own. They're all what's it called? They all contractors or whatever. You know, they they don't have a one entity to fight under, basically. So when it comes to that, when you look at a boxing match, you can't necessarily blame the entity, but you can blame the people that look after them, which is the athletic commissions in their respective state, whether it's Nevada, whether it's California, whatever it is. You have to have certain rules that do not allow for things to happen like deaths on a regular occurrence.
It's actually not on a regular occurrence, John. You act like, how many boxing matches happen on a regular basis?
I couldn't tell you. Do you?
I'm sure that I'm pretty sure it's thousands in a year. So you have one or two deaths, right?
Okay.
So that's equivalent to me about how many times we watch NASCAR or Indy racing and there's a wreck and somebody dies. But here's the thing. I'm not going to
say Hold on. Time out. What you just brought up, and this is, I can only argue about the points that you bring up, right? What you just brought up is Indy racing. So damn near every accident where they can feel, they can see that they have made a mistake, or there's things to learn from, or different case in points where the next time something like this happens, where there's a death, they change the rules.
But John, you're missing the whole point. The point is that every time somebody gets behind a wheel, and every time somebody puts on a boxing gloves, they know the risk. This is the sport of risk. And Chris, to me, you're hypocritical to sit here. You have sat here for the longest I've known you, for the last 20 years,
right,
and sit here and watch the same fucking boxing matches, the same UFC matches.
I'm not saying I'm not a fan.
No, but that's just it. The reasons why you're a fan is the ideal that somebody can overcome the greatest struggle or the greatest adversity. And nothing speaks highly of adversity when somebody gets knocked the fuck out, gets back up, and then fights, and then finds a way to win. That's what life is about. You get knocked the fuck down, and then you rise to the occasion. You're telling me now that the reasons why you fell in love with boxing, which was for those reasons, now all of a sudden you're going to give up because it makes you feel uncomfortable that someone died?
I'm not saying they're not good stories than boxing. And I get that you're a fan, and I'm a fan of boxing. I understand that. But this happens way too much.
It doesn't happen way too much. It actually doesn't happen. It doesn't happen as often you're trying to make it out to be. It just bothers you. You know why it bothers you?
Why does it bother me?
I think because you've gotten older, you're a family man now, and the fact that somebody dying when they don't have to die bothers you. But guess what?
It should bother me.
It should bother
everybody.
But guess what? It shouldn't, because that man chose to sign the contract, that man chose to put on those gloves, and that man knew from the jump that he is one hit away from dying. But he chose that lifestyle because that's what he wants.
I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that. Because, look, dude, every time an NFL player puts his helmet on, he understands the risk. He understands that he's going to go out, and at any point, he could be paralyzed. At any point.
Right. So why is it that when we see a crucial hit where somebody goes down like that, the first thing we talk about is the exact same reaction you have? I feel uncomfortable with him being paralyzed. I feel uncomfortable with him dying. I feel uncomfortable with seeing him in the wheelchair. We need to change the way we hit, right?
Right.
But now we've seen that there's even more injuries now because we changed the way we've hit, because we're trying to protect the brain, and now people are losing ACL injuries. People have...
Because people go from head to the knee.
Because you have no other choice, because at the end of the day, you know what people are trying to say? We should just go to flag football.
See, that's a completely different argument.
No, it's not, because at the end of the day, listen, I'm going to tell you right now, if you don't like boxing, don't watch it. If you don't like UFC, don't watch it. If you don't like football, don't watch it. But there's people that love it. There's people that risk everything for the passion of the game. And for you to sit here and take away what makes boxing, why people even like boxing, It's just ridiculous to me. Just because it makes you feel uncomfortable. No, stop watching
not,
it.
Not at all. Not at all. If I can find any way to make a sport safer for me, for Joe Blow, for my son, for whoever.
I think boxing's pretty safe, actually. I think they've done a great job. And again, I feel like you're taking one incident. You act like there's 20 deaths a year in boxing. There's not. There's not. Because guess what? Usually when you get knocked out, chances are you're not getting back up. But there are fighters that find a way to get knocked down and get back up and win. And again, that has been the merit and that has been the passion of why people love boxing.
I think you can make boxing a lot safer. I think you can make boxing a sport that you don't have to necessarily. You can have comebacks. And you'll see they have comebacks.
Let's just go ahead and ban Rocky. Based on John's perspective, let's just go ahead and ban Rocky. That's the only reason why we like Rocky. Because he got knocked out 20,000 times and rose back up.
It's a movie. Stop bringing up Rocky. That's the easiest thing to do.
No, it's not. Because that's the reason why we love Rocky. You don't like Rocky because he was like, yo, Adrian. You like the fact that he rose from the bottom and found a way, even through the worst adversity, to rise and still find a way to win.
Qua, you're going to have to be referee on this one, bro. What do you think, bro?
I'll tell you right now, he ain't about to throw him.
Hey, man, let.
Say that much. Qua's a man.
Let the man speak.
I mean, look, I get where you come from, John. 100%. Nobody ever wants to fucking see that. Nobody ever wants to hear about a death from a sport. But what Chris is saying is right. You know, like that when with the athletes and the, you know, that this, it's what they chose. It's not even athletes. It's any profession. If you chose to work on like a skyscraper and you are up there dealing, you know, building those, like you deal with the risk of that job. And I don't know the statistics on that, but there's probably a number of deaths per year from people that do that or that are like window washers for those like tall buildings. You know, I'm just using that as an example, but I think any line of work or anything you chose, even, you know, if it's a passion, there's a risk that comes with it. It's the most tragic story. Nobody ever wants for that to be the outcome. But, you know, looking at MMA, there has been deaths in MMA pretty much for the same type of fights. Maybe, I don't know if really in the UFC, but there's a lot of other leagues, smaller leagues all around the world. And it definitely has happened multiple times. And, you know, just looking at boxing alone, they said there's a report that came out in, what was it, like 1995, that said they estimated around 500 boxers that have died from injuries sustained in the ring. And that was 20 years ago. So since then, yeah, it's gotten better. But, you know, I hear you, but like my question, you would be like, what would be your way to help that? Because I feel like the referees and stuff, they do a good job, but they're doing what they're trained to do. They follow a protocol. If someone wants to throw in the towel, they're not going to say anything. You know, the referee is usually always in the best interest of the fighter. That's why someone like the UFC, they'll stop a fight, or even in boxing, they'll you know, they check their eyes, they'll check if their pupils are dilated. And sometimes maybe they don't show
signs
as obvious as you would think. And I didn't watch this fight, you know, but it seems like, or from what I read, Dadashev is his name, Maxim Dadashev. His trainer wanted to stop the fight. But he said he wanted him to stop a lot earlier.
Right.
He said it. He told his fighter, you should stop.
Yeah.
But that's the thing about fighters. And like what backs up what Chris is saying is, you know, how many times, even in movies or in real life, as a trainer or somebody wanted to stop the fight, and the fighter's like, no, I keep going.
Well, it's a problem because, one, the trainer gets paid whether the fight is lost or won. And so basically they get a bonus or whatever. So there's incentive for the fighter to keep fighting and guided by the trainer. In this instance, the trainer did ask him, hey, let me throw in the towel. You saw it's one of the most, because you know after the fact that he passed away, it's one of the most heartfelt clips that I've ever seen in a boxing match, because we have that access now between the trainer and the boxer. But I'm not debating that. It is very, very difficult to say, you know what, how do we make the sport safer? I don't know if necessarily once you get knocked down, that's the end all be all, like the UFC. But I do think that there's moments, if the trainer can see this, the referee can see it. He's right there. The leash that's let on with these other boxers and stuff, at some point, you know, you just can't keep letting it go. Because even in Thurman and Pacquiao, shout out to Pacquiao, 40 years old, won another championship belt. With Thurman and Pacquiao, Thurman gets knocked down in the first round and he gets back up, and you know, and you could see Thurman wasn't lights out. He was still lucid and he was still moving. It he lasted the whole round. It went to a split decision, you know, win for Pacquiao. But excuse me, but the leash has to be cut shorter.
Let me ask you a question, John. Everybody who gets knocked out or knocked down is automatically concussion?
Yes.
You sure about that?
Well, okay, so there's the concussion, right, that can knock you out, and then there's a trigger in your jaw that basically hotwires your brain for a second.
Right, not every knockout is a concussion. So, see, that's the hard part to determine. Not every knockdown is a concussion.
Not every knockdown. Knockout, yes.
Right. Well, usually when somebody gets knocked out, it's over with. I have not seen too many people who get knocked out where they completely hit the ground, hit the floor.
You
got to
watch Tyson Fury and Deontay Wilder. He was knocked out.
It's very, very rare that somebody who gets knocked out can even make the 10 count. So I'm saying, like, I mean, I hear you. And by all means, shout out, not even a shout out, man, just our prayers to the family of that gentleman who lost his life. But a lot of people will also argue that this man lost his life doing something that he truly loved to do. And it is hard for us to sit here. It's hard for me because I get in the same predicament as you sometimes, where I allow my emotions and my feelings to dictate how I feel about the situation. At the same time, I've also been hypocritical in that sense because this has been going on and I was cheering for it. I liked it. But now all of a sudden, I see one of my favorite players or I see something that's on TV that bothers me. And maybe now more than ever, there's certain things in life that bother me more than ever because I'm a family man. But I can't have both ways. Like, for me, I can't sit here and watch boxing for the reasons I watch boxing and then all of a sudden being like, well, I can't watch this anymore because people just die. Like, I know every time somebody gets in that ring, there's a possibility. The problem is that most of the time, we don't see those deaths. We don't know those deaths. So when it is at our front door, it makes you question, why do I like this? Why am I watching this? Like, there is nothing to me more sexier and why I love NFL so much when I see a hit. I love a big hit.
Yeah, we like that.
I love when somebody get knocked the fuck out. And at the same time, when I was younger, I didn't care if they didn't get up. But now I do. Because I think about that person's family. Yeah. And I know where you're coming from. And I respect that. But those same guys, they know. It's one hit away from being paralyzed.
It's like would you still watch and be a fan of the sport if the calls were that tight, you know, like if every time someone got knocked down and the fight was called? Because I mean, you know, even today with these things happening, there's still plenty of fights that get real tight calls. And the first instinct as a fan, you're like, yo, what are you doing? Why'd you stop the fight?
Well, we're trained.
But that's the thing. It's the culture of it. Yeah. It's, you know, I mean, you got to kind of almost. Really, I mean, that's the main blame. The main blame is for the consumer.
It's
the
consumer. Absolutely.
Is the one who has got that bloodthirst. Yeah. That's like, hey, they want to see these hits. They want to. And I think that most of these commissions, whether it be the NBA, NFL, WBO, whatever, I think they do their best to.
No, I don't think anybody wants to have these happen.
Yeah.
But I do think that there is a way to make this safer. What that is, I can't tell off of this fight. It wasn't like one blow, you know, it was just an accumulation of blow on top of blow on top of blow. And at some point, the guy just gave out. And it's not the first time. It's not one. And if it stays this way, it won't be the last time. And that's my biggest fear. Because, like, I don't mind, and you brought up family. I don't mind having my son ever box. But do I want it to the point where he has to sacrifice his life for this? I don't think so. I don't think any parent would.
Well, at the end of the day, that's the crazy thing about it is, like, you know, what? Think about it like this. Every day, and this is a much love and respect for our first responders, our police department, our firefighters. Every day they know. They have to explain to their families every day that they're going out and that they may not come back home, right? And it's sad and it's scary. No, the reason why I'm saying that is because it's sad and scary because, like, think about if you're the wife of the children.
Right.
Like, you know dad may not come back home. You try not to think about it, but you know he may not come back home. But you're not going to sit here and tell a police officer that what they're doing is not important to them and not important to what they feel is right. And the same thing goes for somebody who's boxing. Like, this is what they have signed off on. This is what they have become passionate about. This is what they feel like is the only way that they can truly succeed. And so they know right off the bat. You don't think that fighter, while he was getting tagged, he thought to himself, man, this is not looking too good. But it was in him to keep going on because at the end of the day, this is what he wanted to do. And listen, as much as you don't want if your son was to be a boxer, you're not going to be able to control your son if he wants to give his life, literally his life, for something he's truly passionate about. There's nothing you can do about that.
And that's the thing. I feel like, especially with fighters, I feel like 9 out of 10 of them, that's their mindset.
They're when they get there, yep.
You know, it's a, you know, a multitude of things. It's like adrenaline. So they feel like they don't feel that pain, or they know that they can fight through it. And they're trained to pretty much say, like, hey, I'm gonna take this to the end. That's their mindset. So to me, it's almost like I'm thinking, like, I hope we are alive for the day and age where it's like we have some sort of technology breakthrough to where you can like
identify.
Well, yeah, well, or even have something to where you can actually tell their vital signs,
right,
of all of their internal organs during the fight. And then, you know what I mean? Because
why don't you
nowadays
make these kind of points, John?
Nowadays, kind of, you know, it's still primitive, right? Boxing is still one of those sports that's very primitive, yeah, to where it's like they don't use all these technology. It's kind of like when they test, if they're still, they're just like, if you're still standing and you're responding, you know, like you're good to go. But a lot of times it's almost like you trick your brain, or your brain, you know, your brain is the strongest muscle in your body, right? So your brain is like almost, it goes in a, what is it, like autopilot sometimes. But hey, it doesn't mean that the rest of your organs aren't.
If
aren't
the NFL well. Can do it, the boxing commission can do it. Bottom line, they hold quarterbacks out all the time. They got to do it.
So you're saying basically we should just change it from boxing to slap boxing?
Sure.
Okay.
So right about this time, as always, we got to bring it.
Let the slap box John right now.
We got to bring it to Mr. Qual. And off the dome, what do you have for us today, Mr. Qual?
Speaking of technology, you hear about the robot umpires? And then was it some American Baseball League? I forget what league was that. It's
in a minor league. So what it is? Have you seen this?
Atlantic League. There you go. No.
Have you seen this? you're gonna be so against this, but I absolutely love it. So the in the minor leagues, what they're doing, they're testing out a computer strike box. That's it, basically. Mm-hmm. But there's still an umpire back there that can override and can do account for check swings. So you have a computerized strike box. Anything inside or outside of that box that is there for the computer, and it judges basically what a strike zone is, the distance from the plate, over the plate, and from your chest to your knees. So there's no give and take. There's no leniency as far as an umpire can say. Well, he'll call this game this way, but the next umpire the next day will call the game a different way when it comes to the strike box.
If movies have taught us anything, once robots have full power and control, they will destroy us all.
Eventually,
including our favorite sports.
Yes. Eventually, my son will go into a world that's technology driven, and that's not a bad thing.
No, it is a bad thing when he can't get a job because robots are doing every goddamn thing, John. Like, he, like, we're at the point right now, they just talked about
somebody got a
program. No.
Somebody got some
program. We're getting on a different subject right now. You need to do some research on this. Right now. Right now, they're saying where everyone worries about, like, global warming and everybody worries about, like, nuclear bombs.
We're about to get political here.
No, we're not about to get political. The thing that is truly going to separate us and what is our true demise is artificial intelligence. That's a fact. Like, as of right now, people, like, they're looking in the next 20 years, people won't even have jobs because robots are going to be doing everything, including your job, bartending. What are you going to do? Wait, tape.
I'm going to be on this podcast.
What happens if they have robots doing podcasts? Because guess what? They're probably going to be smarter than us.
Man, this went left quick. Anyways, number two.
I was going to say, I thought they should have had robot umpires a long time ago.
Thank you.
But that strike box is all over the place. You see how many games you like, but isn't how that, the fuck was wait, that wait, called
isn't
a strike
that, isn't
or
that
a ball?
The best thing about baseball, though, is that the catcher...
No!
Time out.
There's no consistency.
Time out. But here's what I'm trying to say. One of the best things about pitching and the catcher in itself is to throw a ball to make it seem like, especially when you catch it, that it's a strike. That is part of the game.
The point is to fool the batter, not the actual where you're actually throwing it.
Right, but that's an art. So that's an art. A good catcher will fool the
umpire. That's what I'm saying. So that's why catcher is so important.
But I completely disagree with him.
Well, you're
sorry, people. I want the call right each and every time.
Yeah. John wants artificial intelligence to rule the world.
Cool. Next subject.
Disappointing.
Please.
All right, so going to the richest franchise in the world here, that Zeke is asking an extension from the Cowboys.
Why not? He should get it. He's the best player on the team.
So Zeke, best player on the team, in my opinion, maybe Amari Stoudemire has a little bit of an argument, but I mean, Amari Cooper, excuse me. So
no. I mean, I'm an Alabama fan, but, you know, Zeke is the
Zeke.
Best.
Okay, so Zeke is threatening to hold out, or there's rumors or reports that he will, to hold out for a contract extension. One, I'm all for it.
Same here.
But two, people, Houston Texans fans, please rise up. And it doesn't have to come from Houston, Texas, as far as, like, the front office. It doesn't have to come from you guys. But as fans, can we demand a top-rate running back? I'm sorry, Lamar Miller. I love you and all that you've done for, but it's time.
What has he done?
I'm just giving guy his props. But it's time for one of these running backs, whether it be Le'Veon Bell, whether it be Melvin Gordon, whether it even be Zeke. Come on. Can we go get somebody?
It's not going to
happen. Top-rate running back, man. The last time we were a very good football team and were consistently in the playoffs was with Arian Foster, one of the best running backs in the league at that point.
Yeah, but he you know, unfortunately, Zeke comes with a history. And, you know, this is a good old boy team. You're not allowed to be a bad person.
Who is a standard bearer for the New England Patriots? I mean, excuse me. Who is a standard bearer? I gave you the answer. Who is a standard bearer for the NFL? New England Patriots. They went and got a murderer. And guess what? They've won championships before him and after him. Nobody's looking at the Patriots like they're a bad organization. Then they went and got somebody who can't stay off the weed. And Josh Gordon, nobody is looking at the New England Patriots like a bad organization. And they still won a championship.
Because they're not a bad organization, because they understand that who you are outside of the field has nothing to do with what we ask you to do on the field.
Thank you. Say that one more time, Chris.
I'm not going to. They just need to go ahead and rewind this. They'll hear it.
Thank you. Call, next subject, please.
Give Zeke his goddamn money.
All right. What do y'all think about Tim Duncan becoming an assistant coach for the Spurs?
Speaking of robots, Tim Duncan playing for the Spurs is basically appropriate.
Give that man his respect. Come on now.
Oh, but he's a great. He's a You know what's so crazy?
I think he's the greatest power forward of all time.
I think he's the greatest power forward of all time.
Yeah, shout for out, being a robot, right?
For being a robot. Greatest robotic power forward of all time.
They're giving Kawhi Leonard the best player in the league.
What was Tim Duncan's nickname?
Big Fundamental.
That's when you watch his game, that's reasons why people don't respect him. Because his game was so basic but so dominant. He wasn't flashy. I mean, like even like if you ever watch him come to the game in his clothes, like it was a t-shirt and like a pair of jeans.
And then
like,
when they changed the dress code, he just wore sport coat over whatever
was. That's what I'm saying. Like at the end of the day, Tim Duncan came to play the game and he played it in what many might say the right way, but there was no flash. He played defense. He played offense. You didn't see a lot of emotion from him. But you know he was seriously in the game,
right?
And he's definitely a Popovich player. And I actually think that, you know, in my opinion, I think Popovich is the greatest coach of all time in the NBA. And I think that I can easily see Tim Duncan being
protégé. Hold on, say it. He's the greatest coach in the NBA right now.
I think Popovich is the greatest coach of all time, based off of what he had and how he's won.
Wow.
Hell yeah, man.
He had three Hall of Famers on the team.
No, he
for
made
a decade.
Wait. Who's the three Hall of Famers?
Ginobili.
Okay.
Parker.
Okay, time out for Ginobili.
And then
Parker.
He had Kawhi Leonard.
No. Ginobili and Parker became Hall of Famers because of Popovich.
Okay.
They weren't highly recruited. They weren't the best up and coming players. Tim Duncan was a high draft pick. He was number one, right?
Yes.
But those other guys were not. He made them into the complete players. Ask them. They'll tell you. If it wasn't for Popovich, I wouldn't have had the success. Greatest coach of all time.
That's another conversation for another day. Next subject, please, or do you have something to say? I'm sorry.
No. Yeah, good. I was a shout out to another podcast. Michael Bisping has one called Believe You Me. And if you heard, if you listened to it at all, he said that he would put money down on Amanda Nunes beating Henry Cejudo in a fight, if they were to ever to fight, which would probably not happen. But you think she would? Miss, you said it, best female fighter of all time. You think she'd win against a male fighter?
So do you want to take it or you want me to take it? All right, first of all, it will never happen. But here's my thing about this whole thing. He's a champion in two divisions. She's a champion in two divisions. She's fought the best of the best and all that stuff. It's a different sport when it comes to what he does and what she does. And when you incorporate everything, he will easily take her down. He won't go toe-to-toe. Now, if they went to a boxing ring or they fought in boxing, she would win. I think she's more of a technical boxer. She's more of a stand-up fighter, and she knows different ways to win a fight with her hands and her feet. I haven't necessarily seen that with Cejudo. Cejudo is an Olympic wrestler, a gold medaling wrestler, and then he's a champion in fighting when it comes to basically ground and pound, and he's excellent at that. It's easier to grab somebody and take them down than it is to knock them out. Period, of point blank. And the fighters that Nunes has beat has been on the feet. Ronda Rousey chose to fight with her standing up. Holly Holmes chose to fight with her standing up. Cyborg is more of a stand-up fighter. So they played her game, and she's the best at that. Cejudo has basically won on wrestling and ground and pound. So when it comes to that, when you break down a fight like that, Cejudo would win 9 times out of 10.
I say we get a Nunez robot and a Cejudo robot and put all their attributes together and let the robots figure it out, and then we'll know for sure.
I'm done with that.
How about that?
All right, I think it's getting to that point where I just want to do a little shout out. I'll give you guys the opportunity as well. But man, what do you think about them Astros, man?
I'm super excited about the Astros. They're doing amazing things right now. Yuli is destroying it right now. He's on a 13-game hitting streak. He's putting out ridiculous numbers. Actually, the whole team is doing, and I told you when Springer came back that pitchers weren't going to be allowed to pitch around certain players because 1-7, 1-8 is thick. It's ridiculous. And Carlos Correa is coming back this Friday, and he was already having a great season before his rib incident. But the point being is that Astros are looking really, really good right now. And again, if you're a pitcher and you got to come up with a game plan, how do you pitch towards this team? There, Altuve is starting to hit. He's starting to come around. Springer's starting to come around. The Astros are something nasty to play with, and most importantly, trade deadline's coming up, and you know they're going to get pitching. So
the trade deadline is important because that's the one pitfall that we have, and we saw it this past series when it came to the Oakland A's. Ninth inning, they were down 2 or 3 points and there's runs, and they came back and won on our relieving pitcher after our starting pitcher went 8 innings, you know, and that's tough to watch, but you can clearly see who's the best team, especially when we come and we play Texas and we sweep them and we play the Oakland A's, and it 1 inning kept us from sweeping them. 1-8, Altuve, Springer, Correa coming back, Alvarez is mashing,
Brantley,
and then Yuli with the 13-game hitting streak.
A couple of podcasts ago, I told you Yuli's about to come around, man. He couldn't. He was just only about to catch fire.
I think that the timing was bad, but he should have been an all-star.
Oh, definitely should have
been. You know, if he would have started this way in the beginning of the season, he would have been an all-star, clearly. You know, you got Justin Verlander and Gerrit Cole. Since 1900, is the fastest to strike out 200 people. The fastest.
Hopefully we re-sign him.
So I heard this one thing about the Yankees and Dodgers running away, and I just felt so disheartened when he completely forgot about the Astros. Astros are right there.
Well, still no one's talking about the Astros, as usual. I mean, why should they? Because they're so damn good. What can you possibly say? They really are. Considering all the injuries they've gone through, no other team that sustained our injuries would be able to even be about 0.5 games behind.
100%.
Behind the top two teams in Major League Baseball. So all I got to say is that when the playoffs come around, man, I'd hate to play the Astros.
100%. I can't wait to see what the full team can do and what we do in the playoffs, man. I just do hope that we do catch a little bit of the trade for, or we catch a little bit of one of these pitchers that wants to be traded. Kawhi, you got anything for us? Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say that I was a little disappointed and heartbroken the fact that I couldn't get that Astros hat that sold out. This past Monday, the Houston Astros celebrated the Apollo 11
moon landing. Did you see that?
The hat in itself is significant, and it's beautiful, and the fact that the Major League Baseball allowed them to play that hat, but it sold out right away. I'm so upset because
really,
online right now on eBay, you can try to get one of those hats for like $198. It's crazy. But the fact that they had the original patch that was on Neil Armstrong is pretty awesome. But I just thought this interesting is that they celebrate the 50th anniversary of the Apollo 11 landing.
Scored 11 points.
Was 11-1, right? Gerrit Cole actually won his 11th game, and he had 11 strikeouts. Right.
Wow.
And then Jordan Alvarez actually hit his 11th home run in that game as well. So
that's awesome.
Just a quick tidbit for those who like those type of facts. It's just significant because we know that the Astros and the Rockets are synonymous with NASA. And I like to think that what makes this city so awesome and why we call it the Space City is because I think we're so much farther than everybody else. And we've come a long ways from a city, from you know, a community, to even our sports teams. So I just think it's awesome that we were able to pay homage to the moon landing. I'm pretty confident that the Astros are going to win another championship. So, yeah, that's what I got to say about that.
That's cool. That's really awesome. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this is the end of the show. As always, thank you so much for tuning in. Share, subscribe, tell your friends about it, man. Tell whatever, each and every way you can support us. Thank you so much. I don't know how else to extend my gratitude. I've been having a blast doing this. Episode number 10. We try to just represent Houston in the best way we can. We get into it all the time, as you can see.
Slide box is full.
Again, check out The Brew of the H. Very good beer. I'm not going to lie. This is one of my favorite that we've had all day. This is one of my favorite we've had doing this show. So thank you. Support U of H. Support H-Town. Peace.
Peace.
Yeah.
Map con loco, haría con Lía, María. Slide on with the fofo, yeah, slide, slide, fofo. Map.